How's it going, YouTube? You are listening to Behind the Wall, presented by Perky Jerky, the official beef jerky of Kimi Räikkönen and Scuderia Ferrari. I'm Kane Junior 88, as always, with my co-hosts, Thermite 917 and Junior Nation 5788. We have a great show lined up for you tonight. We are going to discuss the whole race weekend from Charlotte Motor Speedway with maybe a little bit of Indy and Monaco mixed in. I really don't know. That's up to these guys. But as always, we're going to hand out some awards, give a race rating, discuss our favorite paint schemes, our worst paint scheme of the week, and make our fantasy picks. So, gentlemen, the greatest weekend in racing was yesterday. Well, greatest day in racing was yesterday. But of course, we're talking about Charlotte. So, what did you guys think?
Well, it was better than last year.
Heck yeah.
Holy shit,
That's
last
it.
year. I guess we could just say that. It was just better. Oh man, last year was just so dominated and just, man, you just couldn't, nobody was going anywhere. It just felt like you were watching a slot cars race, and unfortunately we've seen that in many different racetracks over the past, several years. But the Coke 600 was solid. It was still, kind of dominated, hey, by the same guy, Martin Truex Jr. He ended up leading 227 laps, which is over half of the entire race distance. But, he obviously didn't win, and he didn't even finish second. So clearly they were beatable, and that was a good aspect of the race. I mean, there was it was kind of a wacky night too. Like it wasn't it just wasn't like a straightforward race. There might not have been a lot of battling for the lead, but there was just kind of a still enough like action or weirdness, with a couple weird wrecks and obviously the long rain delay and that all in the VH whatever. What the hell is it called? VHC, VT,
VHT.
VHT. VHT.
VHT, MTV, VH1. I don't give a fuck what it's called, but
Save the music.
yeah, saves. Yeah, save the music. Can't save the racetrack, but yeah, just. I don't know, just like some weird elements mixed in, and so I guess it just made for a decently entertaining race. It's a good thing those things happened. Had they not, it would not get a very good review for me, but it was solid.
Yeah, because this was the first race this weekend that had the four segments. I think it went, just fine. I mean, I don't think it really made the racing much better, but you at least knew when a caution was coming out, and unlike last year where there was so much green flag racing, at least this was broken up a little more, and like Tyler was saying, there was a lot of weird stuff going on kind of throughout the night, and obviously for the Indy 500 as well. But for the VHT, the track bite, I guess they use it in drag racing too. It didn't quite work as well as Bristol, but it made the racing better than it would have been otherwise, I think, because they were at least using the multiple grooves to some extent. And I wish there was a little more sliding around and whatever, but I guess it was an okay race, and better than the All-Star, which mostly, everything from now on will be.
Yeah, I certainly will. I'm glad you brought that up. The All-Star was obviously an absolute disaster. That was in part due to the fact that they actually had that V. What? Jesus, I don't even remember it now. Like, I just don't care. Just this, whatever, the substance. That
The
damn
sticky stuff.
substance. This, yeah, the sticky stuff. Oh my God. The sticky stuff. Okay, that was in part the All-Star was so bad because of the sticky stuff. They actually put it on the bottom. Now, apparently I might have
Why would they do
gotten.
that?
Yeah, exactly. But it might have gotten kind of washed away or something. We don't know all the facts because, people just don't ever tell the truth. But it was a stupid decision in the first place to ever put it on the bottom. Why would you put it on the bottom? Now, Charlotte Motor Speedway was repaved a little over 10 years ago. They put these rubber polymers into, the mix, the asphalt mix, and it apparently, like, it's supposed to help the aging process. But we all know, if you've been a fan for a while, that an aged racetrack usually produces some of the better racing. So that's why Charlotte's been kind of lackluster, due to the fact that this repave has made the track stay kind of new. Now,
I was wondering what was up with that.
yes, so that's why.
Because it
So,
hasn't aged at all. It's still like the same color and everything as when it was paved.
absolutely. So the more you
Yeah.
know, the more you know, Nick. I'm glad I could
Yeah.
educate you on that, read a book.
Thank you.
But the so the bottom groove is grippy as shit, especially under nighttime conditions. So, why? I don't know why they made the decision to put that there. It's so stupid. So that kind of really ruined the All-Star race, and it's a shame, but whatever. So then they figured out their mistake, and they decided to put it in whatever the middle to high groove for the 600, and they obviously put several different coats of it down. So it was there and evident throughout the weekend. The Xfinity race was said to be pretty good,
It
right?
was.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, I've had a lot of action. Granted, that was run during the day, so hot and slick, cars slid around more, obviously. So that kind of, is understandable from that point. But the 600 is a half and half. Unfortunately, it didn't really turn out to be that way because of the long rain delay. So that kind of took the last part of the sun, like the racing with the sun out, even though it was kind of a cloudy-ish day, the sun was behind the racetrack. I know, I was there to see that, and it was kind of a hot but kind of cool in a way day. It just wasn't as good as it could have been. And obviously the VH fucking sticky stuff.
VHT.
VHT. A VH fucking T. God
It's three
damn.
letters. Come on.
I know it's three letters. It's three letters. I mean, there's many things that have three letters that I love, but that's not one of them. And so, obviously the race, wasn't as good as it could have been, but that's just the way the Coke 600 is set up, day into night transition. So, when the night really, came into effect, especially after the rain delay, which was forever, especially, being in the stands, that really sucked. But by that point, it was complete nighttime. So what happens? Temperatures go down. So they were as cool as they could have been. But it was still in the low 70s, so it wasn't exactly a cool night. And if it had been cooler, the racing would have been even worse. Because it just gets so grippy on the bottom, and people probably would have been sticking to that, and it would have been super one groove. But cars were running all over the place, though. They were down at the bottom, they were at the top, so there was clearly options there, and I think that does make the VHT a success, and I think they should continue to do that.
Yeah. All right, well, you've been talking about VHT for like the past 10 minutes, so.
I don't want to talk about it ever again, but
No, but let's talk about some of the actual events of the race. I guess we should start with Chase Elliott and Brad Keselowski. That was a pretty crazy deal there. Jeffrey Earnhardt, why was he in the race anyway? He had his
yeah,
little
really.
mess up, two driver's nights. He blew an engine piece of it. Or was it an engine or was it a gear? I don't know. But a piece of it went through Chase Elliott's car. He blew up, caught on fire. Brad Keselowski either got in the oil or just didn't see him coming. But he plowed in the back of him and ended both their nights. And didn't see that coming. That was a, and it was like lap 20. I mean, there was plenty of the race to go. It was just a shame it had to happen that early. So,
It was
yeah.
just a bad deal, it's just a racing deal. It happened, Jeffrey's bucket of bolts failed on him, and man, it was crazy. I was sitting off of turn four high up, and I saw Jeffrey smoking, and I'm like, all right, they're gonna throw the yellow, and the yellow was out. But
Yeah.
on the TV replay, you can see that there's clearly shit coming out of the back of his car. So Chase just obviously, unfortunately, was the unlucky guy to run over that. And man, I didn't even realize it was him that caught on fire at first. I thought Jeffrey was on fire and somebody plowed in the back of him. And it was a hell of an impact, obviously. But man, but you're right. It was actually less than 20 laps. Technically, 19 laps into a 400 lap race. Man, I mean, that's so shitty. And they were done. They're out. That's it.
Yeah.
It was like it
And
was nothing.
Chase started third too,
Yeah.
which really sucks,
Yeah, two potentially good cars that, you never know, could have maybe battled for the win, been in contention, or at least for a decent result, and they end up finishing, next to last and third from last. So, yeah, tough outing for those guys.
And how about that save from Truex and Jimmy getting by them?
Yeah, man. Truex was all squirrely. That looked shades of Trevor Bayne in the All-Star Showdown there. Like, to avoid that wreck, it was pretty crazy. They could have, you know, they could have plowed into it too, you know, because obviously they went through the oil that obviously Keselowski got into, you know. I highly doubt Keselowski didn't see a fucking car stopped right in front of him. So,
yeah,
you know, man, it was just such a crazy deal. It just was one of those things that just escalated quickly, and, you know, we're like, man, like, I can't believe that just happened. But that was pretty much the only action, really, in the first stage. That's what I was
saying. In the first stage. And I don't know if I'm getting, like, out of order, but there was another bizarre incident when Ty Dillon blew up, and then Harvick and Larson got in their oil, or his oil, and Harvick spun but had a great save, and I think Larson just hit the wall, and then he later cut a tire and was out of the race. But... And then at the same time that was happening, Casey Kane cut a tire on the backstretch and crashed, so...
Yeah, a super bizarre wreck, and I'm glad you fast-forwarded, like, 250 laps. So,
I think we need to at this point.
Yeah, I think we should. It was a solid race, you know, and these... you know, those were the couple of the bizarre things that happened that, like, made it kind of crazy. But for the most part, I mean, there's not a whole lot else to say. I mean, you know... Like, Harvick had a problem. He went a lap down at one point. But it was pretty much just, you know, standard racing, you know, and throughout the pack, you know, some passing here and there and blah, blah, blah. Ryan Blaney, whatever, broke an axle, or they thought they broke an axle, you know, that happened. But the attrition rate was pretty decent, decently high for the 600. You know, obviously it's a long race, but, you know, a lot
and
of
it
people
gave it
really
more
kind
of a feel of, you know, it being a tough race again. So yeah. that was a positive, I guess.
That is true. But yeah, then you get into the last stage. And by this point, you know, Kyle had won the first stage. Truex won the second and the third, right?
Did he?
Truex won second, and then Denny Hamlin won the third.
Oh, yeah, Denny came out of nowhere. He was the only one that was successful, like, by staying out or whatever.
Oh, right.
Yep.
I don't even know why.
Menard tried it. Who else tried it? But it didn't work for anyone except Denny.
Stenhouse, I know he tried it.
Yeah, he was the other one I'm thinking of. He backed up fast.
So yeah, it just ends up turning into a fuel mileage race. And man, I cannot believe the events that happened right there. You know, Martin Truex Jr. looked like the car to beat. And, you know, it looked like he might have had the race wrapped up, and that there were several guys that decided to pull some fuel strategy. Austin Dillon, Jimmy Johnson being the main two. And Jimmy Johnson runs out of gas with two to go. And Austin Dillon, who was right behind him, you know, trying to stalk him, trying to get him, ends up inheriting the lead and just has enough fuel, man. Yeah. And he crossed that line and he said he ran out of fuel at that instant. And he gets his first career win. And the biggest race of the year, only led two laps. Biggest race in terms of longevity. Just crazy. Like, it's unreal. You know, there's so many things that come along with that happening. You know, obviously, he gets his first win. The three car is now back in victory lane. That's a big deal.
For the first time since October of 2000, one of the greatest races ever.
Yeah. I wonder who was driving the three at that time.
Oh, yeah. some guy from Kannapolis, North Carolina. I think his name is Earnhardt.
Hopefully he breaks through one day. You know, good kid.
Yeah.
Anyways, you know, the three car back to victory lane. RCR won another race. Holy shit. That's two now this year. They've, gotten in awkward circumstances, kind of, you know, like... They're the company as a whole, they're still not that great. Let's just be real. Austin Dillon is actually 21st in points. 21st! But now he's in a chase. He gets, you know... I'm not going to say they were running like dog shit all night, because I don't think that that's necessarily accurate. But they were about, I don't know, lower half of top 10 to top 15 car. And hey, they played the strategy right. They, you know... Plenty of other people could have tried it and they could have saved, but they didn't. Nobody did. Nobody that stayed out. I think it was like seven people that were trying it. and only one could prevail, and that was Austin Dillon. So
yeah,
they did a hell of a job in that excellent paint scheme, you know, the
oh,
old
yeah.
time style look. But yeah,
and then at the same time, you know, Jimmy was running out and everything, Kyle Busch was passing Truex for second, so I mean that could have been a, you know, factor if Dillon ran out. So
absolutely,
it was just, there was a lot happening right at the end.
Yeah,
so.
And then
really
of course
hectic.
You had right, and then you had Landon Cassel crashing with like three or two to go.
Yeah, that easily could have been a caution.
Yeah,
I guess prop for NASCAR for not throwing a yellow there, even though it certainly could have been.
Yeah, there was a lot of debris I saw. So,
which, I mean, there's grounds to like bitch about that, to be honest, because that's just NASCAR inconsistency at its finest. If there was a lot
yeah.
of debris, then you know they could have thrown the yellow, and they definitely would have in any other scenario. I'm surprised I haven't seen more black hat morons trying to point that out, and be like, they were trying to do it to potentially have Austin Dillon win the race and three car back in the two lanes. Shut up.
Put on your tinfoil hat.
Put on your tinfoil hat and fucking, you know, put your head in a microwave.
And he didn't even have the lead at that point, so then it would have been like they were helping Jimmy, and why would they want to do that?
Yeah. Yeah. So. Yeah, that
hasn't even helped enough.
Yeah, if Jimmy would have won, that would have been, then people would have said that. Somebody would have said that, guaranteed. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. And first win for that crew chief, was it Justin Alexander or whatever that they
yeah.
brought on
Justin
board?
Justin Alexander, yep.
Well, that was his first technical race, too. So,
yeah.
Wow. It was a big deal, and, we still don't exactly know what happened with Slugger Labby either, so I mean it might be a kind of a kick in the nuts, but I did see he tweeted out, very nice tweet, and it seemed like he was excited about them winning, and he obviously plays a part in their team and the building of that team, so you know I'm sure he
yeah.
takes pride in the fact that they ended up winning, because you know I mean what the hell did the new crew chief really do other than call the race, that you know specific race, and they did a good job, and they did what they needed to do. So, well, now that we've gone all over the place about that, let's give some race ratings and move the hell on.
Man.
So, Kane, give us a race rating.
For my race rating, I mean, other than the finish and anything else, it really wasn't, like, an exciting race. I mean, especially in the rain delay, really didn't help much either, so I'm going to give it a 6.5.
All right, Nick?
Yeah, I think 6.5 sounds fair. You know, just a little bit better than the All-Star. Or actually, it was a lot better than the All-Star, but as far as 600s go, you know, I was hoping for a little more. But it still had plenty of entertaining moments. You know, I was on the edge of my seat for, you know, maybe like Chase Elliott's crash and then Austin Dillon at the end. I like fuel mileage races, man. I don't care what anyone says. It can be exciting. You don't know who's going to win until the last lap. So, you know, that was a, you know, pretty solid finish there. And, I want them to get the cars better. I want, you know, Charlotte to be more fun because it used to be a wild one. But I'll take it. You know, it wasn't too bad. So, Tyler.
Yeah, you guys hit the nail on the head. I'll go 6.5, too. I can't, I think that's a perfect race rating. Obviously, it gets a significant improvement over last year. Good enough craziness to keep you kind of in tune. And unfortunately, you know, the rain delay did kind of hamper that a little bit. And
there's like five stages.
Yeah, exactly. It just felt super long. I mean, it's already a long enough race, but obviously,
yeah.
Rain, you can't fucking control rain, so I don't let that really affect my score. I feel like it was a 6.5, and that's it. All right, let's hand out some awards for the Charlotte race weekend. Starting up, first award, Boner of the Week, who is it?
Boner of the Week goes to Brennan Poole in the Xfinity race. Where are you going, man? You tried to wreck your teammate twice. You put him in the wall kind of early. You got tight off of turn four and squeezed him up in there, you know, skadoodled him. and then, you know, a little later in the race, I guess Tyler Reddick backed off a little bit and you didn't see it. And you got him loose and Reddick went up towards the wall again. Wasn't quite as much damage, but I'm sure he was still pissed about that. And I wonder what Ganassi's got to say about that, because he already had a rough Indy 500. Stupid Brennan. Next award.
Next award is Welcome Back, Reality. And that goes to Cale Conley for his Xfinity race weekend. Oh boy, Cale Conley. Why does he have a ride? That's right, he doesn't. He just got a one-off for this year. And after his experimentals in, I believe it was an RCR ride, which he completely sucked ass in, yeah, he has now come back, and it didn't go that well. He spun in qualifying, he spun in the race, ran like complete ass, finished whatever, I don't know, 32nd, couple laps down.
Yeah, whatever.
And just absolutely awful, running behind people that he... That car normally wouldn't run behind. I'm not saying that JGL car has a ton of power behind it, but Corey LaJoie would do better, and that's saying something. So, welcome back to reality, Cale Conley. You still suck. Next award.
All right, our next award is Bad Break, and that goes to Chase Elliott and Brad Keselowski, who, unfortunately, as we mentioned earlier, on lap 20, I think it was, a 400-lap race, and Jeffrey Earnhardt blows up going across the front straightaway, and then part of his car goes through Chase Elliott's radiator, destroys the engine, burns it up. Brad gets into the oil, slides right into Chase, and both are done that early into the race. That sucks.
Next award is Bucket of Bolts, and that goes to Derek Cope. Oh, my Lord. Derek Cope, he's going to run some races. He's already run a few, and he'll run several more throughout the rest of the year for that Premium Motorsports, just complete garbage can, number 55. You know, I was at the race, and you could just see and hear how terrible this car is. Everybody else sounds completely normal, and then, you know, here, you know, 10 seconds behind the field, you know, a lap after a restart, here comes Derek Cope. Like this car is just gonna completely croak and just fall apart at any moment. You know, he even actually had some puff of smoke coming out of the exhaust pipes at one point. I'm thinking, thank God he finally blew up and he could get out of the way. You know, because he was
still going.
He was in everybody's way. But no, he pulled off though. He pulled off. He went into the garage area and then came back out. Come on. He was still out there going. I'm like, what? Stop it! Pull in, Derek. Get that bucket of bolts off the damn racetrack. Go, you know, go down to the freaking Applebee's and share an apple dipper with Timmy Hill. You both drive pieces of shit. Please get out of here.
Go get kicked out of Applebee's.
Yeah, I don't even know if Applebee's has apple dippers. I'm just assuming they do, but they need to go both get some apple dippers. All right, next award.
All right, next award is the Cigar Award, and it goes to, this shouldn't be a surprise, Austin Dillon and the 3 team. Man, they weren't really a factor most of the race. They were around the top 10, top 15. And all of a sudden, it turns into a fuel mileage race, and they were the lucky ones that decided to go for it. Gutsy call, and passed Jimmy Johnson with 2 laps to go. How many starts has he made in Cup so far? Does anyone have a number?
I believe it was 140. I think it was 143.
Yeah, I mean, so for a young guy, I mean, he's been here a while, and he finally got it done with a new crew chief, Justin Alexander. So proud of those guys, proud of you. And they brought it home. They got the first win. Hopefully the next one, you know, maybe isn't fuel mileage or not restricted plate or whatever. I think they have it in them. RCR has been doing a little better this year, even though they have been getting some kind of bizarre wins. But it's just nice to see them back. I know it was awesome to see the number 3 back. Richard Childress is happy. So that's Austin Dillon. Good job for them. Next award.
Were you surprised that Austin could stretch it on fuel? And then, I mean, what mean do you think for Austin to get his first win?
I'm not surprised about anything. Congratulations.
Oh, Kyle! You realize you're not surprised about anything anymore? Well, you know what else is not surprising anymore? You getting the crying towel week after week after week! Oh, Kyle! I don't know if I can do this anymore, man! I don't care that Dale Jr. endorses your childish behavior in the media center after every time you lose a race. I mean, I know this is twice now that you've been screwed over by an ICR driver gambling on strategy at the end of the race after you should have won it. But that's no reason to throw a hissy fit by throwing the microphone around in the media center. Kyle, this can't happen. This has got to stop. Well, not really, because I fucking enjoy doing this, but... Man, dude! This is killing me, man! You're killing me, Smalls! Well, actually, you're not that small, because you tripped over your fucking legs before the race! I mean, I don't know who the hell was taping that, but cigar award to that guy! Because that was freaking hilarious! and then the gold nugget of a mullet came of this old debacle. You pissing your nose. Oh. I bet that was one large nugget that came out of your nostril right there, wasn't it? I mean, I said this before, I'll say it again. It's so sad that your two-year-old son is more mature than you in public than you'll ever be, you salty Snickers son of a bitch crybaby!
Oh! Oh, damn it!
Oh, God. Nick, you just shoved your copyright right up your ass. That was funny.
That was fun. That was good. Yeah, but before Kane has a heart attack, I mean, that was awesome.
Gang, bringing your A game once again, giving Kyle Busch the crying towel. Excellent job. All right, well, enjoy the paint scheme montage and the best from the Coke 600. Also have a worst paint scheme to give out, and well, this team has made a couple of appearances on some of the earlier episodes of Behind the Wall, and they're coming back. Nick, who has the worst paint scheme of the week?
The worst paint scheme of the week goes to Timmy Hill in the 51 car for Rick Ware Racing. The sponsor is Charlie's Soap, and it says charliesoap.com on the side. I washed mine in Charlie's Soap. What, I don't know what mine refers to. I don't want to know, but I do not use Charlie's Soap, so I don't want to go there. But, you know, I hope he doesn't drop it. But
oh, my God. That car should go to prison.
But, oh, my God. It's a nothing paint scheme. It's black. You know, the paint scheme is brought to you by the color black. There's no lines, no nothing. It's just a sponsor. You know, the logo's not bad on the front, but that's all it is. What's going on? Why, they didn't put any effort into it. And like, where the hell are they getting these sponsors from? You know, and JJ aim right, you know, aim right for the garage, because that's where you're going. and I don't know what else to do but make fun of the sponsors, because there's no paint scheme.
Well, what about the front of the car, Nick? What does it say on the front?
Man, it says Chevrolet. It doesn't even say SS. They were too poor to afford to put the SS on. So it's just, you know, the Timmy Hill black Chevy. That's all it is. And, God, come on. You can't even put that on there right. I'm lucky we're lucky it has headlights and a grill and tires.
I mean, that font is so bad, you can't... It's NASCAR 15 didn't even want to put it in their default in-game fonts in the paint booth.
What, for the 51?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, not just for the 51, but for the Chevrolet font, too.
Yeah, it's just generic fonts. It's nothing creative at all. I think, yeah. You know, the name above the window is the most creative thing about it, and that doesn't even look that great.
Oh, Timmy Hill. Again, Rick Flair Racing brings out the worst in everything paint scheme related. So
they don't even have a ficus. They're too poor.
Exactly.
We're walking right into a ficus.
Yeah, they can't afford
a
ficus.
What are we going to piss on?
I tell you what we're going to piss on. We're going right through the front door and pissing on the rug. They're nice, beautiful, probably
Bubba.
Black. God damn it, Kane. I'll piss on. Yeah, we'll piss on Bubba too.
What did Bubba do? Oh, Bubba Burger. Okay, I thought you meant
no,
Bubba. Yeah,
no, Bubba in the Bubba Burger and Bubba in the shop. I don't care. Bubba's okay. Probably sitting back there slacking off anyway. I'm gonna piss on him. Wake him up.
Yeah.
They don't even have contingencies.
No, they can't afford the stickers that sponsors give away for free.
Look, the splitters, you know, yellow or orange or whatever. They got that, but they could afford a colored splitter. They got, you know, American Ethanol logo. They got a, you know, where the gas, you know, whatever.
I think we're done talking about this man's game.
Yeah, we are.
We have to. I'm sad.
I'm sad, too.
I'm sad there's no ficus to piss on, I know,
where's my ficus?
Alright, now it's time for fantasy picks, and we're going to first off review the fantasy picks for the race weekend. Now, obviously, we did a Memorial Day style challenge, and that's where we picked a winner that for all three races, for the Monaco Grand Prix, the Indianapolis 500, and the Coca-Cola 600. Now, the winner will get 10 free bonus points to add to their points total. And the average finishes will start with last person, Damani. Poor Damani. He had an average finish of 19th over his three picks. Coming in third was Kane. He had a 16.6 average. And the winner is Nick with a 9.3 average. He beat me by just one whole position. I had a 10.3 average. So, very close, tight battle. But Nick, you know, finally has something go his way. You know, he's been busy sucking. But does not suck to suck anymore because he doesn't suck. Not at least this week. So
not this week.
Nick's picks of Sebastian Vettel, who won the Monaco Grand Prix. So Nick also picked Joseph Newgarden, who unfortunately was knocked out late in the Indianapolis 500, but still got a 19th place finish. And he picked Kevin Harvick in the Coca-Cola 600, and he finished in 8th place. So he beat me with, you know, I had picked Truex, who got 3rd. I picked Valtteri Buttass in Monaco. He finished 4th, and 4 Fernando Alonso. I had to say something about this. I picked him to win the Indianapolis 500, and boy, did it look like he was gonna at least contend for the win, but I really thought he was going to win. And unfortunately, his Honda-powered shitbox let go on him very late in the event, and he ended up finishing 24th. So, had that not happened, I was looking really primed for a win here, but it was not meant to be.
Just like an F1.
That's true. But, obviously the Memorial Day challenge was just for 10 free bonus points. We're obviously still doing the normal fantasy challenge for Charlotte itself. And I was coming home with the win with picking Martin Truex Jr., who came home in 3rd with 61 points. And Nick finishes in 2nd with 41 points. But plus he gets the 10 free bonus points, so he gets 51 for the week. And Kane and Damani ended up picking, you know, the same pick, which, you know, whatever, we make up the rules as we go. So they picked Kyle Larson, who came home in 33rd after his late trouble, and they only got 11 points apiece. So now, we're going to let Damani HD go first this time, and he picks Jimmy Johnson for Dover. It's a pretty solitary pick. He's won there a million fucking times. Hopefully he doesn't win. But, Kane, who is your fantasy selection for Dover?
My fantasy selection for Dover, he won there last fall, and he should have won last night. I'm going with Martin Truex Jr.
Alrighty. Nick?
Alright, I'm going with the guy that could have won there in the spring last year if he was a little more aggressive, and that is Kyle Larson. Charlotte was easily his worst finish of the year. Every other race was very, you know, solid in terms of finishing position. So I think he'll redeem himself at Dover. I think it's a track he likes and excels on. So Kyle Larson is going to win, and you're all going to cry, and I'm going to get some points because I need them.
Well, you know, who are you kidding? You know, you suck. So you ain't getting any points. Man, this is a, you guys took all the good ones, really. But I'm going to go with
Derek Cope.
No. Definitely not Derek. Why would I choose somebody that's so slow? I'm going to go with a really fast car, you know. Timmy Hill. No, I am going to take a huge shot in the dark. I have a points lead to work with here. I don't care. I am going to take Clint Bowyer to win at Dover. I don't know why.
I was
Clint
thinking,
is my Bowyer.
Yeah, when you said you were going to take a gamble, that's who I was thinking you were going to pick right then.
Yes.
Yeah.
Clint Bowyer. I saw a stat that there has been 25 drivers that have won a race since Clint Bowyer has last won a race of his own, and that was in 2012. Wow. So Clint Bowyer has not won a race in a very long time. They have been solid, not quite winning material, but they've been solid. Dover is a place that can be crazy at times, so you never know what's going to happen. I think that they're, like, especially in the midst of this season, there's been some weirdness, there's been some weird winners. I think it's going to be time for another one. So, Clint Bowyer shocks the world and ends his extremely long winless streak. Well, that is all for this incredible episode of Behind the Wall. Probably the most well-put-together one we've ever done. Just get ready for the outtakes. So, for KJr88, for Thermite917, for myself, JrNation5788, you have been listening to Behind the Wall, presented by Perky Jerky. You've been behind the wall, and thank you for listening. That car is so much better than the Dow car. It's better than the fucking Cheerios car. All that bullshit.
I don't think he's with Cheerios anymore.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Because I haven't seen a Cheerios car yet this year, and I don't think their decal has been on the car either. So yeah, I guess General Motors just decided, or General Mills, my bad.
General Motors. General Motors. They produce cars and Cheerios.
Yeah.
Come down and get your brand new Chevy and a complimentary bowl of Cheerios. General Motors. Damn it. See, now why the fuck isn't Nick here? Because this is the type of shit that could be going in the outtakes, but...
Yeah.
Fucker! Fucking Nick LeMacki! I've already lost the plot, man. I've got to gather this shit up. I'm serious. I'm out of it right now. I don't know what the hell the deal is. I'm rambling on. I'm a fucking born a rambling man. Rest in peace, Almond, brother.
Greg Almond.
Greg Almond. I mean, an Almond Joy right now in his memory. But I do think that the VHC did... But I do believe the VHT played a fucking...
Hold on. Motherfucker. I just not let Hawker.
This is already going off the rails.
This is horseshit.
Oh my
Stupid
god.
Stupid NASCAR. Just call it the sticky stuff. The black semen or something.
Black semen.
Oh god. This is not good. I'm embarrassed. I really thought I could see it. Or feel it. See and feel it. Oh, God. I'm thinking many things now. I gotta get back on track. I don't even know. I've been the only one talking. Somebody jump in and help me!
Yeah, I think we have to.
I don't know. We have to, yeah.
Jeez. I don't know what the...
Okay, I'll continue and finish with what I was fucking saying. Okay. So the VHT, you know, it could have worked out better, but, you know, God damn it, Nick! You're fucking laughing. You're laughing. I'm trying to be serious.
Well, you finally got it.
I finally got it, okay. And you fucked it up. So thank you. I'm gonna enjoy my almond joy angrily now.
Okay. I'll be quiet. I'll just
think about the last time.
Shut up!
Just do the next award.
Next award, God damn it! The next award goes to Derek. Derek Ass Cope. Oh God. Everybody else sounds, you know, normal as they're going by, and then fucking here comes Derek. Just, oh my Lord! It was such a horrible sound. It was, I haven't seen or heard sounds that horrible since gas chambers in the Holocaust. Oh my God!
What are you doing?
You were freezing around the Holocaust. Oh my God, Tyler. Oh,
I watched a movie called Schindler's List, and it's about the Holocaust, so it was on my mind.
I thought you were going to say you haven't heard anything that bad since, you know, Kane sounds.
Yeah, but you actually like that, so.
Well, we do like that, and, we do and like here that. Is why.
Ugh, God. Oh yeah.
So I went there.
You went there.
That's going. I'm redoing the award. Now I'm going to the outtakes.
I don't even know if it's a go in the outtakes. Jesus.
Yeah.
Oh Jesus. This is so bad. I'm dark.
Yeah.
I'm dark, man.
Yeah, you are.
This is a family show, damn it.
This is a family show. You proceed to say damn it right after that. That's good. Anyways. Next award.
Next award yet? Okay.
Now I'll have to redo the audio bit. God damn it, Nick.
God damn it! It's gonna be okay.
I know, but I wanted to say it. I wanted to coast you into the next award.
All right, say it. Yeah, okay.
All right, next award.
Well, thank you.
Stop laughing.
That was a lovely intro, and you know I'm happy you thought of me in this time of the podcast. Oh my God. The next award. Shut up. I'm okay. We're doing this.
Yeah.
Next award.
Next award.
Shut up! Oh my God. Oh, I'm dead.
This is the sloppiest thing I've seen since Cody Coughlin's fucking truck debut. Oh my goodness.
Sloppiest thing since him eating a sandwich.
A meatball sub.
Oh my God. Yeah, meatball sub, and then he follows it up with a PB&J. You got the fucking J all over the place.
Jags!
Jags! PB&J.
They didn't even race this week, and we gotta do it. Alright.
Next award.
Oh, alright, I'll be quiet. Just introduce it.
But what else does it say, Nick? What? Damn it!
VHT?
VHT. That's what it says. This is VHT on the front. VHT, VH1, fuck them all. He also picked Joseph Newgarden. Holy shit. That fucking Slim Jim got to me. My throat was getting a little raspy there. God damn, everything tonight. Nick also picked Joseph Newgarden, who unfortunately was knocked out late in the Indianapolis. God damn it!
Yeah.
Nick also picked
Indianapolis with that VHT.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's something wrong with the car.
The car? Coming to the chicane, the car shut up. I have never driven with this load of powder. What? the powder, the car's not going anywhere. Kimmy, do you have anything to add? There's an engine in the car, and it makes the car go around the racetrack, and
and I got screwed by my own team.
I started pole, and I finished in the second position, and that's about it. I'm gonna go now and see your wife. And started first.
How'd you do, Kenny? How'd I do? I your wife, that's what I do.
Why? You just ask your wife. Anyhow.
Good old Kimmy.
We're gonna let Damani go first and his pick.
Do you even say like where everyone else finished? Like Pagano and all them?
Yeah, I guess I didn't do my picks.
No, I didn't do all of those. I just said how many points you earned. But if you want me
to
go through
them. You said where Newgarden finished, where Alonso finished, where Vettel finished, yeah.
Well, fuck them.
All right.
Fuck the rest of your picks.
I thought you were going to say every pick, so whatever.
Simon Pagenaud finished 14th, Daniel Ricciardo finished 3rd.
Forget it, just move on.
Yeah, you're damn right, forget it. This show has gone on for too long. I fucked up too much shit. I was only going to say, you know, some of the key points. You know, Kane and Damani sucked ass in the Memorial Day Challenge. You and I had a close battle, so that's why I covered the two of ours. Who gives a
and
shit
that's
about
all
those
for
teams?
Another episode of Behind the Wall. See you next time.
You've been behind the wall.
That's all the time we have.
That's all.
Yeah.
Yeah, we gotta go, kids. God damn it! This has been a disaster. This has been the worst episode and the most, like I said, it's the sloppiest thing since Cody Coughlin's truck debut. Good God.
I think he'll redeem him.
So Kyle, you finished second again. Probably could have won if Austin Dillon didn't gamble. What are your thoughts on today's race? Yeah. Thank you, Kyle.